Hi, everybody, and welcome to Brooklyn Raga Massive's weekly concert and discussion and workshop series. Brooklyn Raga Massive is a collective rooted in Indian classical music, South Asian classical music, and we've had weekly concerts and events for 9 years, only interrupted by the pandemic, and of course now we're online like everybody else. And next week, we actually have our first jam session live and in person back at Branded Saloon, where we originally started it. But today we have slightly different from what we usually do. Usually we're in dialogue with musicians about their music. We have started a social justice series, which will be continuing next month. And I would say that this kind of cultural appropriation discussion is a very important discussion that, you know, in BRM, we've been dealing with it internally and externally in many ways over the years. And as individual artists, you know, anybody who's playing kind of music from not here is definitely, or even people who are playing music here, you have to understand what we're talking about here. So today's discussion was actually started by our good friend, Josh Farrar from the Brooklyn Macomb Hang, friends of ours. And he was talking with Johnny Farraj here, and Johnny and Marianne Franklin had been in a dialogue about, they both written books dealing with the cultural appropriation and other topics. And they've been having this discussion. So we said, why don't we carry it into this BRM format? So we're really thrilled to welcome the Marianne Franklin and Johnny Farraj. Marianne Franklin is a professor of global media and politics at Goldsmiths University in the UK. And she's been active for many years in human rights advocacy and research on internet policymaking, alongside her exploration of topics in arts and culture in our digital networked age. She's trained in Western classical music, and her latest book is Sampling Politics, Music and the Geocultural, I believe released this summer, right? In July. And then Johnny Farraj is a Lebanese-born musician of Palestinian descent. His main instrument is the rick. He also plays oud and sings. All right. Creator of the website macomworld.com. I did not know that. Johnny is co-author with Sami Abu Shumais of Inside Arabic Music. Welcome, Johnny. Welcome, Marianne.
Thank you.
So good to have you here. Marianne, would you like to start with your own introduction?
Oh, yes. Hi. Thanks very much for having me. This is really exciting because Johnny and I have been communicating purely by email. Mm-hmm. So this whole event is a chance for us to see each other face to face on screen. And hopefully very soon in the future, we can meet in real life space, a vegetarian or meat space, depending on your preference. So, I think I'm just going to start really, we started to talk about this issue because I've been exploring different sorts of sampling across different sorts of music making. And it was because I needed to check in with an expert in Arabic music making, having discovered Macomb World and spending many happy hours learning and thinking and hearing things differently. So I got a hold of Johnny, and thanks to Johnny, I was able to follow some lines of inquiry for the central chapter of Sampling Politics, which is all about a very famous album called My Life in the Bush of Ghosts by Brian Eno and David Byrne, and some of the interesting ways in which they back then pioneered forms of sampling in the studio, but also pioneered this conversation. And a lot has changed since they first laid down these tracks. And I'm not here to throw around accusations, but it has been a very fascinating journey. So that's my little opener. Johnny, over to you, because we've just been wildly emailing. I don't know how I got any work done in the last few months.
Thanks, Marianne. Thanks, Neil. So again, I'm Johnny Farraj. I'm not a musician by profession. I'm a software engineer. I have training in computer engineering, but music is definitely my passion. And so maybe because I'm not a full-time musician, I had the luxury of writing this book over a period of many years with my co-author Sami Abu Shumais. And so basically, this book, is a very wide has a very wide topic coverage for Arabic music, but it also, besides dealing with music, it deals with meta issues related to music, like cultural appropriation, orientalization, colonialism, politics behind the music, the power dynamic between East and West, which is like a fundamental undercurrent in this book. And I was obviously very interested in the research that you're doing, Marianne, because it touches on all of these subjects, not just on ordinary Arabic music making, but it touches on appropriation, on using Arabic music outside the Arab world, on, again, the power dynamic, etc. So I really appreciate this opportunity to be able to talk about something different than actual just Arabic music making. I think these subjects are very important, and they're inseparable from Arabic music. You can't just learn about Arabic music without understanding where it falls in the world order and what happens. And so, I'd love the chance to elaborate a little bit more on that.
I just wanted to add that in the context of this discussion, we're talking about sampling, not just the electronic sampling or borrowing from a previously released track, but also use of different instruments from around the world within Western music, or it could be either way. It's a two-way street. Why don't we talk about the My Life in the Bush of Ghosts example? Why don't we start with that?
Okay. Well, this is the big one where I spent most of my time in three different archives: the British National Archives, the Danish Royal Archives in Copenhagen, and somewhere else I've forgotten. Oh yes, the National Archives in Scotland, because that's where the original tapes and the field notes of two ethnomusicologists actually reside. So, and then I discovered, of course, that My Life in the Bush of Ghosts was drawing on a previously released record, which is called Music in the World of Islam, which was a side event on a large part of a larger festival in the 1970s called the World of Islam Festival. And that in itself is another project which I've begun in the meantime. So what we're thinking about now, in fact, is quite opportunely, because we're looking at this in the day after, or 2 days after, the 20th anniversary of 9/11. We're looking at this just as Afghanistan has once again hit the headlines in the most tragic way. And we're also realizing that geopolitics is kind of shifting and moving all the time. So My Life in the Bush of Ghosts, we can't judge it quite in the way we could back then, which was 1981.
We should just add that people who don't know, there's a David Byrne album that was released in what, 81?
Yeah, 81. Yeah. 1981, David Byrne and Brian Eno, and I have the vinyl version, and many people, we thought it was still a very interesting record.
Yeah.
So it was released just after, the Iranian Revolution. So it in itself is just really, really full of all sorts of external and internalized references. So what I want to try and show for May is the issue is what happens when, as Johnny quite rightly puts it, when music from other cultures, whether it be South Asia, traditional African music, whatever that might be, Afro-Caribbean music, but particularly music from the Middle East and North Africa, becomes an exciting source for Western artists. And because of the kind of politics we have about the nature of the Arabic world or the Muslim world, a whole lot of things can happen. So I'm just going to show you a more recent version of what happens, if I may, Neil, rather than play that famous track.
Sure, sure.
Yeah. I'm going to play a track by Leonard Cohen from the 2014 album called Popular Problems. And the issue is that I was so dissatisfied with what I could not find out, which is how I ended up talking to Johnny and reading his book and getting into Makam world and, of course, going to these archives, because the way we talk about these other musics as they're integrated and appropriated and recreated is just not adequate for our understanding, even as new listeners. But I'm going to play the Leonard Cohen track. And if anybody out there knows whether this singer, this vocal is actually being laid down in the studio, or if it is actually a sample, please tell me. I'd love to know. I can't find out where it's from, but it kind of illustrates the issue that My Life in the Bush of Ghosts, with three of its tracks, and I'll play one of them later if I can, shows. Here we go. I'm going to share the sound only. And here's the track. Is that okay, Neil?
The war was lost, the treaty signed, I was not cut across the line, I was not cut, though many tried, I live among you, well disguised, I had to leave my life behind, I dug some graves you'll never find, the story's told. With facts and lies, I had a name, but never mind. Never mind, never mind. The war was lost, the treaty signed. There's truth that lives and truth that dies. I don't know which, so never mind.
Okay, I've shared quite a bit of that first opener because it's quite standard actually to have this happen, that there's a long intro and in comes the exotic vocal. Now, I don't know whether this is the vocalist who have been listed for this track, don't strike me as the singer in this case, but this is exactly what the early period of studio analog and soon to be digital sampling did, you know, just like rap and hip hop did, but under very different circumstances and different sorts of cultural reference points. Eno and Byrne, amongst many musicians, just inserted these tracks to add all sorts of things. Now, I haven't got far enough in the Leonard Cohen track, but it's a classic way it's done formally, long intro, and then you insert this vocal and then it returns later. I'm not quite sure what significance it has for Cohen. Maybe it's his lyrics, but that's just an example of the kind of thing that can be fascinating, but can also be problematic. So that's just an example. Johnny, you might have a comment on this.
I mean, I'm sure it's fascinating for a Western listener that it might be like you could argue to a certain degree it's educational. You know, you're being introduced to a new sound, to a new language, to a new, entirely new scale. Like this lady, she sounds Egyptian. She was singing in Makam Rust, so I can tell that, which is completely clashing with the first part of the song. It's totally out of place. You would never juxtapose this Makam with this kind of music. But anyway, it has a positive side if you're a Western listener. I don't know. If you're an Arab listener, you think like, okay, what's this lady doing here out of context? It sounds very cheesy, but the deeper issue, which also I felt when I heard the track by David Byrne and Brian Eno, is two things. The erasure of this woman, like we don't know her identity. And if you're a Western listener, you don't even know what she's saying. So it's just this exotic sound, and all the words are basically erased. It's kind of like she's being muted, but without being muted. So the erasure, the anonymization of the lady. I mean, her name might be on the credits, but she's not a participant, you know. And I hate how this is done. It would be great to include Arabic music, but make it an equal player in the song, not bring a snippet, erase her identity out of context and just kind of you're essentializing the Arabic part into some kind of an exotic clip. And Arabic music is extremely rich. I mean, they're taking a huge tradition that's like 1,000 years old, and they're squeezing it into this tiny, tiny clip that's essentialized and anonymized. And this is my objection.
Exactly. Thanks so much, Johnny. And also for letting us know it's Makam Rust. It's really, yeah. I found this out. I had this Leonard Cohen a CD I'd picked up somewhere. Now, it could be on the CD cover, but it's nowhere that I can find online. And that's exactly the big problematic, not so much whether it's good or bad music or wrong, but that you don't know who it is. And we should know at least who it is. So I'm going to play an example, Neil, from my life in the Bush of Ghosts. I don't want to give away my...
I could just add that probably all the other musicians are credited there. Yes. So why not her?
Discogs, two other vocalists are there. And I'm pretty sure the two women mentioned, two of whom have sung for Madonna, are not the vocalists in this case. Johnny's already identified.
But with the Bush of Ghosts, it's even a deeper problem. It's even a bigger problem than that. But go ahead and play it, and then we can, you know.
I'm going to play not the track, the two tracks that Eno and Byrne sampled from. No, the one track. No. Eno and Byrne sampled, in fact, from three tracks from Arabic music from the Arabic world, and two tracks from My Life in the Bush of Ghosts sampled from one recording, and that's where my whole the whole chapter looks at. I want to return the singer to the story because it's over. She herself is also very unhappy with the way her performance was treated. So I'll leave that to the reader because I'm trying to sell my book as well. But there is another track that's used in the same way we just heard from Cohen. 2014, this is going back to 79, 1980, 81, and it's called A Secret Life. They bring in these new titles, and it's from Tawfiq. Is that the right way to say it, Johnny?
Tawfiq.
What? Tawfiq.
And, Tawfiq.
I'm going to play 20 seconds from that. And what they do is another long intro. I won't give you all the long intro, but they take one tiny maval from one of her very long, beautiful tracks and insert it once again in this very now quite familiar way. And I just want the listeners to hear just how it works formally. So let me share my sound again. Bear with me, people. The little pause here when I do this. And then share. Okay. So I'm going to talk over this because it's a long intro. Eno himself is on record as saying that the original track had a lot of long, uninteresting intro. You could argue that this also is a long, perhaps not so interesting intro, but it's part of the style that they were actually pioneering.
That's the Maqam Bayati.
Exactly. That much I do know now, Johnny.
Right.
Thanks. But the point is it's the big dramatic moment in the original track.
Right.
And their ears are right. They pick up this really gorgeous, gorgeous moment. And they realize that this is a very important place in the original song. So this is just two examples of what both the problem is and what the opportunities have been since the late 70s technology. So that's where I want to sort of set my kind of kind of position here up.
Are you going to play the track by Dunya Yunis so that we can comment on it? Yeah, okay. Just like a few seconds.
All right, okay, so bear with me. Johnny, perhaps you could just give me a moment to find it.
Sure.
Dunya Yunis is who again? Why tell us?
She's the lady who was sampled by in My Life in the Bush of Ghosts. And she was originally featured in the recording called Music and the Word of Islam. And then from there, Brian Eno and David Byrne sampled her, correct? And inserted her in one of their tracks. So my bad feeling in this case is everything I said earlier about erasure and essentialization, all that applies with one more very, very massive dimension here, which is the elephant in the room, which is Islam, okay? This fascination of the West with Islam and the whole Orientalism, first of all, Orientalism, is very detrimental to us and to our music. But what's even worse here in this case is Dunya Yunis is not a Muslim. And the music that she was performing, which is a mountain style mawwal, is mostly sung in Christian mountains. And so this whole hypothesis of equating Islam with the Arab world or orientalization of the Arab world completely falls apart when you discover that the Arab world is not entirely Muslim. Lo and behold, you know, there's Christians, there's Jews, there's, you know, all sorts of atheists, and it's a very diverse world. You cannot exotify or exoticize Arab Christians. The whole equation falls apart. The only way you can exoticize them, because then they won't be too exotic, right, by the West, because all of a sudden, wow, if they're Christians like us, they're not that exotic. Let me see. We have to make them all Muslim. We have to homogenize them. And then everything coming from that part of the world will be linked, lumped together with Islam, right? And so that CD that or recording that was done, Music in the World of Islam, it lumped together, you know, ostensibly people from the Arab world who were not Muslim, and then that's how she ended up, nevertheless, you know, not any less exotic, because she's under the banner of, you know, music from the world of Islam, but she wasn't Muslim, and this was not an Islamic tradition, which is equally beautiful, but it just happens to be like that. It's a gross misrepresentation of Islam and of music from her village, you know, mountain village, etc. The whole thing is so badly represented, right?
Yeah, I mean, this is what my chapter, thanks to Johnny's help as well, and the archives show that it's a kind of accumulation of many errors, accumulations of presumption, accumulations right. of a hearing of one music journalist who I cite, I can't remember their name, saying it sounded like an Ayatollah's call to prayer. Well, that in itself is insulting. But the fact that the very sound, what you're going to hear, or the sound you've just heard from the other track they used, should be seen as an Ayatollah call to prayer, quote unquote, is in itself a misrepresentation, whether or not she's Christian, Muslim, Coptic,
right.
you know.
Yes, yes, she's not singing religious music in any shape or form, you know.
She's singing, like, I think it's almost equatable to Danny Boy for the Irish, you know.
Yes, yes, pretty much.
Danny Boy, everybody starts falling into song. Well, it's a bit similar.
Yes. If you equate Danny Boy with like hymns of the Catholic Church, for example, like it's a very bad misrepresentation.
Now, before I play it, I do need to note for the public record is that this young woman, she was very young at the time, this recording was done in a private setting, and it found its way onto this compilation for Music in the World of Islam, this museum exhibition during the World of Islam Festival in the night, unbeknownst to her. So there's a really, really bad
Horrible.
Taste.
Yeah.
So she was never paid.
Oh no.
Not never paid. She was never consulted, never asked for her permission. To me, like this is the consent issue is a much bigger issue than the commercial side of things. You know, I'm gonna talk about this later. The issue of consent and actually having a choice into who samples you and where it ends up, I think it's a much, much more important issue than the issue of money.
And in fact, much as I'd like to play it, I think I won't because buy it, you can find it.
Okay.
I'm going to play, in fact, I'll look up another person singing, Tony Hanna, singing a version of the same song, mainly because I want to respect Dunya Yunus's discomfort that I, and she was very, very kind to talk to me through her daughter.
Right.
Because she has every reason to be suspicious of journalists, academics, and
of
anyone
course.
Wanting to find out. So, but it's the most extraordinary vocal. So anyone could go to My Life in the Bush of Ghosts, and go to the track called Regiment. And it carries the track. I mean, it's the vocals that are the track. And Eno and Byrne do certain things with it, which I go into more detail. But I think on that level, I think I'll have to refrain from playing it. It is on Spotify, the original, original compilation. And so she has no control anymore over the circulation of her private recording.
Right. So
the family have closed access to the original master tape. For that reason, in the Copenhagen archives.
But it's not a very special recording. I mean, it's a recording that you could hear any day, any time in Lebanon. It's not a rare performance by a rare singer of a rare melody that's never been heard before. It's like the most common melody that's very, very widely available. I mean, she has every right to, you know, to withhold permission, of course. I'm not saying, but you know.
But of course, legally, and maybe we'll get around to this, maybe I'd be interested from the point of view of Brooklyn Raga Massive's network, is that legally, clearances were done in the original record, legally, because copyright was the record company, okay?
Right.
And we have this problem as authors, of course.
Right.
And so on terms of the thin level of consent, consent and clearance was done and all that. But it still remains gorgeous music. It's still, our ignorance is revealed at every turn by the way we receive this track as non-Arabic music consumers, shall I say. It became an unexpected hit. So, yeah, it just took a life of its own. And it kind of reveals the problem, but also underscores what we're missing out on when all she's called at the back of the original album cover, which was the human voice in the world of Islam, which in itself is odd because nearly all those tracks on that compilation from field recordings are, again, secular songs, work songs, right. songs.
Right.
There are two religious songs or devotional songs.
Right.
And one is, in fact, I'm going to play, if I may. Is that okay, Neil and John,
yeah.
if I could play?
Sure.
Just to show you the context in which this, in which the West has talked about the music of the our former imperial subjects and how imperialism and colonialism is so alive and well.
I'm going to elaborate on that. After you do this, I'm going to elaborate on that.
I'm going to play you something from the BBC Radio 4, 1976. Please, people, hold on to your hats because I'm simply playing to illustrate and ask ourselves how much has really changed. So just bear with me. I have to get. Yeah. And
1936, you said.
No, 1976.
Okay. 76, sorry.
So this was a big set 76. Of share. So I have to share first before I can do it. Now let me just get there up to my playlist.
I also look forward to hearing Tony Hanna, who's also a Christian from the village.
Yes, I figured he was. Yes. Well, I'm just going to play the introduction by, it's called Kaleidoscope, David Perry, Overviewing the World of Islam Festival. And I just... just listen to it. There are just so many connotations going on. 1976.
Turkish.
Oh, really? Okay.
A sound familiar to anyone who's ever traveled to North Africa or the Middle East. Often, in my experience, bellowed in your ear from a rooftop amplifier at 4 a.m. It's, of course, the Muslim call to prayer before dawn and dusk each day. And each day in London and several other cities for the next few months, we shall be immersed in the Muslim religion and culture known as Islam. Because the World of Islam Festival, as it's called, is nothing less than a takeover. It consists of numerous exhibitions, concerts, lectures, publications, films, folklore, poetry reading, the main items of which we're hoping to do some justice to tonight. Let's to begin.
So he goes on to talk about something I forgot, if I even knew it. I forgot I knew it, that Richard Burton had apparently disguised himself as an, I quote, Arab, and had gone gone to Mecca. And then they play a recording of Richard Burton himself talking about this extraordinary immersed experience dressed as a, quote, Arab. So that's how it gets introduced already. So we have an Orientalist, you know, ongoing imperialist colonialist approach in the mid-1970s, the middle of the oil crisis,
right.
just prior to the Iranian Revolution. And the story I uncovered with the National Archives, in the British National Archive, was extraordinary, but that's another talk.
Right.
But if I can play a Gene Jenkins, who is the ethnomusicologist who oversaw the Music in the World of Islam compilation records, 6 LPs, of which include Dunya Yunus's rendition of Abu Zuluf. And I want you to hear what she plays there, because that will be my final point. And Johnny, it's over to you after that. Mm-hmm. So let me get this sorted. Here, Jean Jenkins, who, you know, had spent a lot of many years traveling the Middle East, North Africa, Central Asia. She was an instrument collector, and her collection's actually, you can go and see it at the Scottish National Archives. Anyway, so she talks about Sufi music, and this is one of the few or three tracks on the original album that is devotional.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, only one of three or maybe four, I could be wrong. So I'm going to play you what Jean, and just listen to the track she plays, and then you'll understand what I'm getting at.
Sure.
Right, wrong one. Here we go.
I can tell from his accent that he's Turkish.
Okay, now this is the Jean Jenkins track, and just keep reading, and I'll get up. It says, Gene Jenkins presents audio samples from the Islamic world. So even the term Islamic world, as we know, is problematic. So that's the beginning. She's halfway through, she's asked.
Perhaps the simplest of all forms of brotherhood music might be found in a tiny village in the Sahara, where you would get maybe 10 or 12 members of the local Sufi sect gathering together, singing and chanting from the Quran, as perhaps were the earliest of all the brotherhood groups. من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. All right, well, here we have, in fact, a track that David Eno and Brian Eno and David Byrne used as the first track, and they called it Quran. It was also one of the tracks on the original compilation
that
Jenkins and her colleague Olson put together. And that's the track that got them into trouble. And they had to withdraw it from the next issues, not all around the world, just the UK. I think the UK and Australia, New Zealand, Canada, maybe the States. But I had a look, and the track still exists on other issues because a local Muslim leadership said you can't put music to the recitation of the Quran. So that was the first sign that Eno and Byrne got. They say they quite admit it. That in fact, there are loadings and there is a long historical cultural tale behind the sort of samples you use. So I just wanted to show that actually, I never found the original recording of this in Jenkins's archives. Maybe I didn't look hard enough. But it's on the show, it's on this radio show, and that's how I managed to find the original track. But this is the problem. I also want to move on in our conversation to some of the opportunity exciting things. But that's enough for me for the moment. Johnny, what do you really...
I'm actually very happy that the owners of the music or members of the culture where the music came from actually had a say in how that music was used. Because, I mean, again, going back to the sampling question, the most egregious part in my view is not the commercial aspect of the sampling. It's not sampling someone and not giving them, royalty. To me, the bigger problem is cultural, right? It's sampling someone... without their knowledge, that would be really bad, or without their consent, and also not giving them an opportunity to agree or to decline the sampling without, not giving them the chance to actually hear the final product and decide that, is their sample compatible with the final product? Is it misrepresented, or is it, is it presented in a positive light, or is it completely taken out of context? There's so many issues to me that are cultural, other than the legalities, but I mean, we can talk, if you want to talk about the legalities of sampling. I mean, sampling happens with Arabic music, but I don't think it's a big problem that it's big enough that, we're suffering from it and we, it's not a huge problem. To me, the cultural undertones of sampling are the problem, and the remnants of colonialism and Orientalism, all the isms. This is the problem for me. It's not the sampling. There's not really that much sampling going from Arabic music into Western music. There's rare examples, but let's mention one example: Jay-Z, which a lot of people might have heard of. I'm gonna share my screen, if I may. So. This is an article from The Guardian describing the legal battle. So basically, Jay-Z, a hip-hop singer, sampled a song by Abdul Halim Hafiz. So let me contextualize a little bit. Okay, the Abdul Halim Hafiz is an Egyptian crooner. Okay, this is him here. And he If we were going to compare him to like someone in the American world of music, maybe Frank Sinatra or someone like that, okay? He's a very well-respected figure, immensely popular. His popularity goes outside the Arab world. I mean, I have Iranian friends who know Abdul Halim Hafiz really, really well and memorize all his songs, even though they don't speak Arabic. So he's like crossed outside the Arab world. He's hugely... And he always was like dressed very, very properly. He had always a, you know, a suit. His hair was nicely done. This is the period of like the black and white movies. And so if I can play. You know, there's a proper pajama, a proper robe, you know, he lives in a like a well-to-do apartment. So there's this image about Abdul Halim. This is from a movie called Fata Ahlami, which means the boy of my dreams. It's like a romantic comedy from 1957. Okay, and the song was composed by Baligh Hamdi. Baligh Hamdi is an Egyptian composer. He's a huge deal in Egypt. He composed many of the songs by Umm Kulthum and Abdul Halim Hafez and Warda. So he's like a huge, big deal composer. And so this is kind of the context that the song was taken from, and look at where it ended up, okay?
It's big pimpin', baby. That's right. Big pimpin', spinning cheese. Gee. You know why, thug 'em, hug 'em, love 'em.
Okay, have you heard enough? So basically, there was a legal battle between the heir of Baligh Hamdi, the composer, and Jay-Z. And then I'm not sure what the outcome is of this legal battle, but that's, to me, like, that's not the most important point. Again, okay, of course they should get royalty for their sample, but more importantly, you can't take this song and put it in this video. I mean, it's offensive. It's offensive. I'm not judging Jay-Z or hip hop videos or anything. It's just I'm like, if I was the composer of that song in 1957, never in my wildest dreams would I imagine that my song would be like plugged into that video, taken completely out of context without my consent to add insult to injury. So all of that is the problem, really, that I kind of want to highlight here, as well as the, you know, the lack of consent, the erasure, the essentialization, the same old problem, you know. And then the other problem I wanted to highlight, which Marianne, you touched on, colonialism and the relationship, the power dynamic between the colonial Britain, let's be specific, and its British subjects. So let me share my screen again. I did a very quick search on Google, and I searched for CD cover songs with Arab women. And the first one I got was this one. So if we go to Amazon, okay, Arabia, Women's Voice, okay? The exotification, the orientalization, the veil, the eyes behind the veil, you know, this could be a plausible Muslim woman in one of the Arab countries or Muslim countries, but I wouldn't say it's typical, but in this kind of media, it is typical. And this is the part that's offensive. And then we go to like the list of the singers, Najwa Karam, Nawal Zughbi, you know, Madonna, these Julia Butros, these are all Christian Lebanese singers, nothing to do. And even the Muslim ones among them, like Latifa, etc., they don't look like this. Even the Muslims don't look like this. The Christians certainly don't look like this. What is this obsession with veiled women in order to sell this kind of music? Like, can't you sell this music without this Orientalism? And Orientalism, like, remember, it doesn't work unless you equate the Arab world with Islam. You cannot orientalize Christian Arabs because the whole equation falls apart. So you need to basically make this bold assumption that the whole Arab world is Muslim in order to orientalize it. Otherwise, the equation doesn't work. And thus this, you know, I'll show you another cover. Arabic love songs. over 2 hours nonstop. If you look at this Arabic writing, any Arab would read this and tell you this is, first of all, left to right instead of being right to left, and the text is not cursive. It should have been cursive. So no Arab person read this and proofread it and agreed to it. So some non-Arab person wanted to essentialize. Again, we have the veiled woman this time in red, but it's the same idea. And also heavily made up, you know, objectification, orientalization, misrepresentation of the language. And then you have, you know, you have the album. You look at those, okay, there's men and women in this album, right? Of course, the logo is a woman, is an Arab or Oriental woman with the veil, even though this is a very mixed, it's probably a very nice mix of music of men and women, Christians and Muslims, your average playlist, right? But this is the problem. Again, one last example on Spotify, international Arabic tunes. No Arab singer looks like that ever. So that's the problem. You know, I just wanted to highlight here. Yeah, back to you. Yeah.
I think, you know, the fact is that, you know, the sort of racialization as well as the misrepresentation of the complex cultural, extraordinarily rich cultural and musical and linguistic area in which you're talking about. There is a colleague of Brian Eno who's cited as saying that the sound of Dunya Yunis was some North African vocal. Well, she's Lebanese. So get your geography right, at least if you're going to insult someone. This is uninsofar as
of course,
ignorance feeds these kinds of misrepresentation. But it's the problem with this sort of analysis is, for me, as I discovered as I got through the book, I had five very different cases, is that a whole new area opens up and you realize there's a whole lot of stuff happening from Egyptian musicians and African musicians. Sampling isn't just the West plundering the non-West. There are some really extraordinary examples that go back to 1944, which I'm going to play if I may, Neil, just keeping an eye on the time.
Right.
Where musicians from all around the world and different cultures are experimenting with the technologies that allow sampling to take place as we understand.
Sure.
So in that sense, I became more and more aware, particularly as I got through this chapter about which we're talking, the life in the bush of ghosts, music in the world of Islam, human voice, Christian vocal traditions and music traditions being sort of subsumed under this idea that there's some Islamic Ayatollah.
Of course, you can't have orientalization without homogenization. You can't, if you're going to orientalize, you have to reduce the entire Arab world. You have to erase all of its diversity, right? And also not just religious diversity between different traditions from different countries. You know, the entire Arab world to the Western, like, simple-minded listener makes one music. And it's not like a diverse universe of so many musical traditions. I mean, we're like 300-400 million people with a lot of history. So as you can imagine, we don't have one music. I mean, this was one of the problems we encountered in writing this book on Arabic music, is we had to, which musics do we cover and how much can we cover? And how do we explain that this is not every Arabic music? This is just one little sliver of Arabic music tradition, you know, that happened in the Middle East, you know, in the mid 20th century. That's all we're talking about. There's so much more outside that. But when you go and orientalize, all of these are homogenized into one, you know, kind of opaque musical tradition and type of people. And then you can just lump them with the Orient or the East, and then you can basically do what you're doing.
And that, of course, you know, brings bring South Asian culture and music into the conversation.
Sure.
India is a vast country with many religions. The exotification there is that Hindu spirituality, yoga, right? But, you know, there's actually more Muslims in India than there are people in Pakistan, right? This huge Muslim population, huge Christian population, Sikh, Jain, tribal peoples, many different things going on there. Then, of course, there's caste issues, which will actually be the subject of our social justice series in October. It's going to be an interesting discussion. But at the same time, you know, there's this confusion, I would say, even amongst, you can include India in the arable world in terms of this confusion as to what is what, such that even like myself, I'm a sitar player, and I, you know, walk around in New York City all the time with my sitar. And, right. you know, people say to me, hey, Ravi Shankar on the subway. No, Ravi Shankar. Is that a sitar? Oh, yeah, Ravi Shankar. Then so many times, you will not believe, so many times the next thing they say is, I like belly dance. And I'm like, okay, well, yeah, belly dance is not from India, not really related. But that's part of the problem. And at the same time, you know, there is like lots of mixing of, you know, different sounds. Even I myself have played with a belly dancer. So am I part of the problem or not? So I wanted to actually talk about in the description of our discussion today, you wrote copyrights and copy wrongs, right? So we've been talking a lot about copy wrongs, but what are the rights? First of all, we don't want to copy, but what is the right way?
Well, I think we need to start addressing this from the point of view of musicians from who are living in the West, growing up in the West, first, second generation, or musicians who came to the West from various traditions, and how they proceed to experiment. I think then we see what's right in a sense, and you know, all the different loadings. So I'm going to start with a really old track, old as in 1990s, an old track from Asian Dub Foundation. It's one of their first tracks, and it's called Rebel Warrior. And Asian Dub Foundation, you know, UK-born band that had pulled from Jamaican dub and, of course, South Asian music in very experimental ways. And this is one of their tracks they still play. It's on their playlist, apparently. Oni Ruta Dust tells me. He's the bass player. And I discovered the original recitation. So they're doing not unlike what Eno and Byrne did. They're raiding their parents' video cassette vinyl record collection. And they've got this wonderful recitation from Qazi Nazrul Islam's Bidrohi poem, which has been recited by his son, easy to find on YouTube. And they take this and they paraphrase it. So they sample directly from the recitation. They also use an alap from, I'm not sure what track at all, Neil, but it opens the song, opens the track. And then they both paraphrase and they sample in a form of respect, a signifying in the way that socially conscious rap and hip hop artists do. They're signifying or understanding the culture from which they're drawing, what they're sampling from. And they recreate this extraordinary poem for you know, the 1990s so-called post-multicultural Britain, with all the various critiques and hope and energy. So I'm just going to play the original, a little bit from the original recitation, which would have been in their family's collections. I don't know, Neil, if you've got a vinyl version of this knocking around somewhere, but you might recognize it. Just, I'm going to go now to video, go to my YouTube. Hang on, here we go. And I'm going to share and go to, sorry. Here we go.
Balobir, Bolo unnato mamoshir, shir nehari amari nato shir oi shikhar himadrir. Balobir, Bolo mahabishsher mahakash phari, chandra surya graha tara chhari. ভুলক দুলক গোলক ভেদিয়া খোদার আসনারস ছেদিয়া উঠিয়াছি চির বিস্ময় আমি বিশ্ব.
Well, it gives me goosebumps. I don't know what he's saying. I've read various translations. So once I did know what he was saying, I could follow the anglified text. And that's the most extraordinary thing. I think everybody should just listen to this recitation on its own. There are many people who do it, but this is what Asian Dub Foundation did. So they're sampling, they're pulling on various sources, literally sampling, but they're doing something very, very different with this track and what it means from the Bengali point of view, from second generation British musicians, and they're making a political statement, which is a form of what I argue in the book, is decolonizing the very issue. Instead of being passive, they decolonize it by the way they make this music and put it together. So I'll just play the first bit and then
Don't let them come.
So in that sense, what they've actually done is they've actually sampled from the end of the poem, the real climax. So they start really quietly, and they've sampled actually from the end of the original recitation. And they paraphrase, and this is a very different approach to the original material. It's a very different approach to mixing Western technologies and Western idioms, rock, dub, rap, you name it, with their own culture. And I think they're very successful at this because they do it in very even-handed way, very, very thought through. So all the sort of connotations for the listener who knows the poem, who knows the language, who understands the historical references, for the listener who comes from, you know, these communities growing up in urban London, in often, you know, really difficult neighborhoods, there's all sorts of things going on, and yet you can still dance to this track. And as Onirita does insist, you should be able to dance and also have political music. So they have a very particular...
Sounds amazing. Sounds great.
And it's a really great track. There's another one I'm going to play because we all love it, Neil, if I may, Corn Please. Shop from the 1997. And this is not so much sampling. What it's doing is referencing. It's a poppy tune. Corner Shop is a joke about the fact that certainly in the British UK setting and its colonies, I'm a New Zealander, that you go to the local corner shop and it's owned and run by people from South Asia, all parts of India and Pakistan. So they call themselves Corner Shop, and they put this together in a homage, as a young boy would, to a very famous Bollywood film star, Asha, is it? I'm not quite sure, never know how to say her last name.
Bosley,
it is Bosley. Asha Bosley.
She's a prolific recorder of Bollywood songs.
And a sister of Lata Mangeshkar, who's also featured a lot in Asian Dub Foundation tracks. So anyway, their homage is not so much the music, but the actual text, the actual references. So just for fun, I'm just going to play this. I'll start at 2 minutes in, and then I'll play one more. Hang on, share screen. What am I doing? Yes. Share. Because, you know, you get carried away with all the music you've got together and whatever. So... Now I have to find my screen. This always happens to me. Always happens to me. Hang on, bear with me. Here we go. So, a really catchy riff, a big hit. She's the one that keeps and so they're singing to Asha Bosler and how gorgeous she is and how they're the homage to the 5 record, homage to the final. Then they start to do this list, and you know, some people might understand what they're talking about and others might not, but there's a combination of post-colonial generations, cultural references. So that's just a bit of fun, but that's another way of doing it and creating and reinforcing your autonomy and your knowledge of the different sources from which you're drawing, your intimate knowledge of it, you know, from what you've heard as a kid. You know what, and also not just one source, multiple sources, and that I think is the tension that a lot of us don't understand. That these generations of musicians growing up between cultures, within cultures, and together with cultures, have knowledge from more than one source, and it's really confronting as a Western trained analyst to realize just how poorly educated we are.
I think it's wonderful, like to show this after everything we've said about bad sampling, to show good sampling, or you know, a good use case of sampling. It's very comforting to actually see that at the end. Like this is a beautiful conclusion of how things should be done, as opposed to how they've been done so far.
And I guess the final one for me is, and I guess after that, there's the Toronto Tabla Ensemble, who Ritesh Das. I don't know if he features in your network, but they this is purely instrumental, and they've got a track called Sample This. So in fact, simply supposedly samples, it's not clear to me technically what they do, but it's also, there's a lot of joy and life and a respect in this particular mix. So just let me get there. John, did you want to segue while I find the track, just so we don't have to pause?
I was thinking of something I wanted to quote, you know, back to the topic of lumping not just all the Arab musics together, but lumping Arab and Persian and Indian. It's done, you know, it's widely done. And there's a book that I I love to criticize in public over and over again. It's called This Is Your Brain on Music from 2006, where the author, lumps effectively Indian, Arab hyphen Persian, as if there is an Arab Persian music, which there isn't. But he basically created this genre of Arab hyphen Persian music. And he talks about their scales and their microtones, and he's a bit of a microtone denier, but without getting into, it's like he's denying 1,000 years of music just, you know, because he's a graduate from MIT or wherever. It's like, you know, never mind the thing about microtones, just the lumping of Indian and Arab hyphen Persian musics as one tradition. It's even wider than the Arab world. The problem with orientalization is so much, like, it probably goes all the way to China if you want to really explore.
I would say so. North Africa all the way to China.
Right,
I mean,
right.
But that goes to the whole world music concept as well, which is such a terrible term. I hate it.
I hate it too.
I happen to live in that world, and there's not much I can do except talk about it right now, because other like venues, they don't want you to talk about this, like, oh, you know, they're happy to have that. But world music was a term that was created in the late 80s, early 90s by a bunch of record company executives. They had a meeting and they wanted to talk about this emerging phenomenon of Paul Simon's Graceland and Peter Gabriel's records and music that they were using on their records, artists from faraway places. And then, okay, Ladysmith Black Mambazo, where are we going to put them in the record store bin? So they put they created the world genre. The other finalists were tropical music and some other more problematic ones. But we left with world music. What is world music? That is like, it has no meaning at all.
This was the last shelf in Tower Records, and they needed to call it something. And so they put everything else in one shelf and called it world music. And that's how you're absolutely right, for marketing purposes. But now it's a thing in itself. You have university courses on world music. Which is very, very unfortunate. And you also have people fighting that trend. You have ethnomusicologists who are trying to decolonize and say everything is world, obviously. I mean, I don't have to explain to you, but they're trying to take back the term or stop using it, or basically treat every music as this Western centrism. I mean, I could spend another hour talking about Western centrism in Arabic music education in the US and in the Arab world even a little bit, but I'm not going to do this now because this is outside, but it's a big problem. And it's also like a spin-off. It's another aspect of, you know, post-colonialism and the power dynamic is we can only teach Arabic music using Western theory and paradigms and, you know, approach and notation, all that stuff. But anyway, that's for another episode.
Yeah, exactly. And it's a whole historical precedent why, you know, the West wants to get a hold of the Arabic music. 2000 plus, because, you know, we must standardize, we must modernize, that's still as well. But back to, you know, the point is, you know, the context of the sort of commercial global music industry, you know, world music's been a very successful brand, hasn't it, Neil, to sort of package a whole lot of sorts of musicians, bring musicians into Western playlists. Now, of course, we've got our streaming services to help us do that. But I think musicians are very strong agents in all this. And, you know, musicians who are trained in the classical South Asian traditions or Arabic classical popular music, you know, Lebanese, Egyptian pop music, you know, the music making itself is so strong. I think it can still speak above, I'm a bit of an optimist, can still speak about this kind of reductionism of the dollar. Mm-hmm. And I think the Toronto Tabla Ensemble have been around for 30 years, but you don't have to know anything about tabla to understand the energy and joy in this kind of track. So, I mean, it's purely instrumental. There's no references to, like we heard with Corner Shop, there aren't sort of literal texts, but I just want to play it and see if we can think about good, quote unquote, good or acceptable ways of sampling and using and collaborating with musicians that don't necessarily mean you have to always say it in words. I'm not sure if this is going to work, so bear with me.
Okay.
Yeah, we probably have to wrap up soon, actually, come to think of
yeah,
it.
Yeah, we can listen to this and then we'll wrap up. Yeah.
Okay. Having said that, I've now lost my I've now lost my link. It'll come. It'll come. I got it queued. Here we go. I've got it queued. Yeah. So I'll just play a little bit. Now it's called Sample This. So, you get to find out other examples, or are they bringing in different performances? It goes on like this for quite some time.
Sounds good.
So that's an example without words. And I have a couple more, but Neil, you need to call the time on this.
Well, I mean, it's been an amazing discussion. I just wanted to kind of talk a little bit more about, you know, the good side of it. I say, you know, in terms of working, we're not saying here that nobody should be working with other cultures and nobody should be, you know, cross-referencing and sampling. We're not saying that at all.
Not at all.
But what we're saying is that we want to treat these other cultures with respect and you know, some scholarship, you know, do some research. It doesn't take a whole lot. You got Spotify. Listen, you got the internet. You can look it up. It's like, there's so much, there's a whole world of music out there. And to use and abuse is no longer acceptable, you know. And if you want to, as speaking as someone who's you know, made their whole career out of you know, I play sitar and study the South Asian classical, the raga music,
right.
But I always mixing it up, and you know, and there may be times where even I myself, even as a, you know, South Asian American, have not done my, I was early on, you know, you're still young and you don't know. And so the point is that we all need to learn and give the respect and appreciation. Right. Any final thoughts from you?
I think that I agree with everything you said. And I think a bit of scholarship, but you know, sampling, instead of sampling, why don't people collaborate? You know, you want an Arabic singer, bring an Arabic singer. Yeah. Like I like the example of Led Zeppelin, who actually brought, you know, Moroccan and Egyptian musicians. They brought Hossam Ramzi on tabla, who's like the most famous Egyptian tabla player. And, you know, they featured him and he has the name. You can, you know who he is, you know where he's from. And they featured them, they collaborated. Instead of sampling some Arabic rhythms, collaborate, you know. And in an environment like New York or a metropolitan area like London, there's got to be musicians you can collaborate with instead of sampling. Sampling is a little bit cowardly, you know. It has so many problems, you know, hiding the identity, essentializing, misrepresenting, and also you can be completely ignorant and sample something, you can get away with it. If you collaborate, you can't be completely ignorant anymore because you're working with a person, with a human being. So, you know, from human to human, collaboration is so much more, you know, so much more conducive to dialogue and to representing the other person fairly as an equal, etc., than sampling. So instead of sampling, collaborate.
Yes.
Yeah, I have two recommendations because the time is short. Tanya Saleh's Intersect video promotion, where she, it's copyright, Neil. She attributes everyone and everything on there, so you learn as you see. But I'm going to go back to, I'm not going to say anymore. I'm going to finish with sound. 1944, Halim El-Dab. He's now been finally credited as the first, electronic music sampler in the tradition of electronic music. So Johnny, people who like to have the music itself coming from the music itself.
Yeah.
And this is called Tabir Alzar. Did I say it vaguely properly? And Anyway,
I've no idea.
He went through a street in Cairo and he recorded this, what's supposed to be a particular ceremony, exorcism ceremony or a cleansing ceremony.
Oh yeah, it's Al-Zar. Okay, so it's about a Zar. So the Zar is like a musical exorcism.
Exactly.
But people were, you know, are more interested in the music than the exorcism. Oh, and it's sometimes it can be just the music from an exorcism without the exorcism, you know. Like you can play Zar music, but yeah, it usually includes lots of frame drums. It's very beaty, very rhythmic. Yeah, it's beautiful.
Okay, well, see, this is why I need Johnny, guys, because every track I find, he helps me. I'm at another dimension. I'm just going to finish right. by playing El Dub's electronic piece from 1944, old-fashioned tape recorder. Then he mixed it and did amazing things with it. So it may not quite sound how I expect, Johnny. And then that'll be my last comment for today. So just let me, I'll go to my screen because I have to do it with, here we are. And it goes on for about 20 minutes, but this is a very cool.
Thank you for sharing. Thank you for sharing that. Yeah. That's really fascinating.
That is fascinating. A lot you said about that. But thanks so much for allowing us to continue our conversations, Neil.
Well, you know, we could be going on, I'm sure, easily for another couple hours here. We'll have to have a part two of this later on. And so thank you very much, Marianne Franklin and Johnny Farraj. Really appreciate you both.
Thank you.
When you show your books, Marianne Franklin's books, Sampling Politics.
Hold on, I got a copy of it.
Thank you, Johnny.
Okay.
Thank you.
Sampling Politics.
And then Johnny Farraj's book, Inside Arabic Music.
She was nice enough to send me a copy of her book, so I have a copy of her book.
So you can check those out and read in much more detail about all this stuff. And I'm sure... they're both very open to you contacting them if you're or me about exploring these topics more.
I'm on Facebook. I'm reachable on Facebook. I get lots of queries like that on Facebook.
All right.
I'm old fashioned.
And what Maqam World is your website?
Yeah, amazing website, guys.
Maqamworld. Should I share it?
Okay. We'll share it that in the chat in the
okay,
in
no
the,
problem.
Tomorrow. Yeah. Or
tomorrow. Okay.
Yeah, and so check that out for all things you wanted to know about the Maqam World. And next week, we will not be having an online event. We will be having a live concert and jam session at our very first location, Brenda's Saloon, here in Brooklyn, New York. And so with that, I'm going to say good night. Thank you, everybody.
Good night. Thank you.
Thank you. Good night.
Thank you. Good night.